nothing too big for him. Well, hey, good morning, Harvest. Let's stand to our feet as we sing and worship the Lord this morning. All right, here we go. This is where worship starts. Here in the temple of my heart, remembering who you are and all you've done. This is your majesty. All I have tasted and I've seen, remembering who you are and once again.
Here we go.
on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within.
Yes, it does.
Over you real quick, where the word of the Lord says, praise the Lord, my soul, all my inmost being, praise His holy name, praise the Lord, my soul, and forget not all His benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. What a great reminder this morning. If you haven't got the memo, we're entering into a season of Thanksgiving. If you didn't buy your turkey yet, you're a little late. With all that being said, I would love for us to spend a few minutes reflecting on the Lord's kindness, the Lord's goodness, the Lord's faithfulness in your life, and just give Him thanks. And maybe you're in a season right now where thanks is probably hard to do. You might be going through some things and you're saying, I'd love to, but I'm just not there emotionally. That's okay. Look at your hand. If you have five fingers, just start there. Lord, thank you for these five fingers. If you're wearing a shirt, which I hope you are, God, thank you for the shirt. If you have shoes, God, thank you for the shoes. Start there. Because there's so many people all around the world that don't have these things. If you're a believer and you've been redeemed and saved, you have a lot of things to be thankful for because God saved you. He's chosen you. He set you apart. He has purpose for your life. God created the plan of salvation for you. Jesus executed that plan. The Holy Spirit sealed that plan. And you are eternally secure because of Jesus Christ. Amen. So let's take a few minutes right now. Thank the Lord for whatever comes to your mind and heart. And after these few minutes, I'll sing a song over us as we continue in worship. So come on, let's take some time and thank the Lord. Maybe you're here today and you're still trying to figure out this whole Christianity thing, and maybe you haven't accepted the Lord as your Savior. Maybe you don't know Jesus. Can I just say we're so glad that you're here. Today could be the day that you meet the Almighty Creator. Today could be the day where your eternity is secured in the hands of God. Today could be the day where your life can be radically changed and never the same, and you will feel a longing and hope and purpose that you have never felt in your life. If that's you today, can I just encourage you to lean into that moment and don't leave this place without talking to someone about it. Let's sing these lyrics out of thankfulness to the Lord.
In everything, with everything, for everything, thank you, Jesus. Everything, with everything, for everything, thank you, Jesus. Everything, with everything, for everything we sing, thank you, Jesus. Everything, with everything, for everything, thank you, Jesus. Our Father in heaven, the light of salvation, know how good it is
Yeah.
except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah.
And set your heart upon the cross. We'll never know the sacrifice you made for all our sin and all our shame. You took the nails and took our place. No one else could do what you have done. One name is stronger than any grave, than any throne. Christ exalted over all. From the grave where death would die, you rose again and brought us life. You're reigning now, the Savior.
Buenos días, iglesia, ¿cómo estamos? See, some of them know what I'm saying this morning. Es un privilegio que estén con nosotros esta mañana. Mi nombre es Cristian, soy el pastor de Harvest en español. Si usted me está entendiendo, quiero conocerle. Después del servicio voy a estar afuera, quiero conversar con usted esta mañana. Hello, family, welcome to church this morning. We are so glad that you are here. My name is Christian. I get to serve as the pastor for Harvest en español. We meet here at Rolling Meadows in Elgin every Sunday at 10 o'clock, and we are so excited to be here worshiping the Lord and reminding ourselves who He is to each one of us. If this is your first time here, I would love to meet you and answer any questions that you might have. Why don't you sit down? Please have a seat. If this is your first time, I would love to meet you out there in the lobby, answer any questions you have. If This is your home already. We would love for you to fill out our Connect card. It's in our app, Church Center. And it's the best way for us to know how we can serve you and minister to your family the best way possible. So please make sure that you do that in our new app. Christmas is coming. I love Thanksgiving, so I'm holding on to that. But Christmas is coming, and we want you to be aware of that because we want you to start planning. And more than that, we want you to start praying. We want you to start praying for people that need to hear about the story of Jesus. And so we want you to know that on Christmas Eve, we're going to have two services, at 3 and at 5 o'clock. And we want you to start thinking about who you would like to invite to those days and to those services so that they can hear about the hope that we have in Christ. We love to pray for local churches that, like us, are in reaching out their community in the name of Jesus. And today we actually get to pray for a local community to us, our neighbors. We are praying for Meadows Christian Fellowship and their pastor Michael Mackens, and we are going to be praying that the Lord blesses their efforts, like us, to reach out this community. Psalm 100 verses 4 and 5 reminds us of this. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him, bless his name, for the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Salmo 100, versículos 4 y 5 nos dice esto. Entrad por sus puertas con acción de gracias, por sus atrios con alabanza. Alabadle, bendecid su nombre, porque Jehová es bueno para siempre. Es su misericordia y su verdad por todas las generaciones. The psalmist is reminding us that the reason why we are thankful to God is because of his faithful love, because he is good, and he's faithful to all generations. When we understand that, it leads us to respond in thanksgiving. And the best way we can do that during this time also is through your giving. On the screens, you're going to see some of the ways that you are able to respond in thanksgiving to the Lord by giving. You can do that today. You can do it throughout the whole week. This is one of the things we've been doing as a community. We are praying that God will help us to be more generous. More generous, not just only with our resources, but with our time and what the Lord has given to us. And so we pray that you will grow in that generosity, especially as we look to Thanksgiving. Would you please pray with me this morning? Lord, we are so grateful to be in your house, to worship with your people, to be reminded of who you are, and how incredible and faithful you have been to all of us. As we come to this time of Thanksgiving, may we reflect and look to you as the giver of all good things, as James reminds us. Lord, we pray this morning for this local church, for Meadows Christian Fellowship. May you be with them this morning. May you bless their pastor, Michael, as he preaches your word. May you encourage them this morning to continue to seek after your face, Lord. We pray for us too. We pray for each one of our campuses that we will look to you as we continue to study the life of Joseph. May we be challenged and encouraged by listening to your word. It is in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen and amen. Would you please welcome people around you as we get ready to listen to God's word this morning?
Hey, Harvest. Really, really glad to be with you. Hope you have a copy of God's Word. You're going to need that. We're looking into God's Word together and continuing in this series. Hey, it is Thanksgiving week, and if you're like me, I'm a big like smell person, and one of my favorite things about Thanksgiving is like on the morning when all of the things are cooking, and you're, oh yeah, You know, you're like snacking on all the charcuterie and stuff like that. But really, I mean, man was not meant to live on charcuterie alone. But every turkey that proceeds from the oven. So, you know, you get to that point when you're like, I don't know if you're like me, but I'm always like, is it ready yet? Is it ready yet? And you sort of go up and you check the oven. You know, does anyone else get your hand slapped every once in a while? Like, quit opening the oven. It needs time to cook. Looking at dinner, is it ready yet? Is it ready yet? It's not. Not yet. I know you want the dinner, but if you keep taking the time to open the oven and let the heat out, then it's never really going to be ready. And a lot in life is like that. We take the time and we want it ready right now. Like, is it ready? Is it ready? I'm back in 3 seconds. Is it ready yet? And we're hopeful that it is. And a lot like in life is like that we want it right now, but in God's providence, he's determined that some things are going to take time, that there's going to need to be a lot of work done behind the scenes before it comes to fruition. And all of these things are done in our life according to God's plan, his purposes, what we call providence, and they're done in his time. Even if we want to keep checking the oven, we're going to see a meal that's ready finally today. But first, let's take a moment and pray. Father, we are grateful for your word that you've given us, your perfect word. And we pray that you would take our time together, take this imperfect messenger, and you would illuminate the pages of your word so that we could be encouraged and challenged and that we would love you in increasing ways in our life, we pray in Jesus' name, amen. All right, so hopefully you have your Bible. We're going to put the scripture up on this screen here, and I'm going to go to that. But I really think it's important that you have your Bible, a copy of God's Word. If you want to do that electronic or paper, it doesn't really matter to me. But I think it's helpful for us to be looking into God's Word together. We have a lot of blue Bibles. If you're new, they're all over each of our worship centers on every campus. It's actually on page 38 in our blue Bibles. We're going to be in Genesis 44 today, 44 and 45, looking at all of this together. Now, we're continuing in our series looking at the life of Joseph. We've called it Intended for Good. Joseph, at this point, is risen to the second in command, only to Pharaoh. He's one of the most powerful people in the entire world at that time. His brothers have come trying to buy food because of a famine that's in the land, and they've come there, and they don't realize that this most powerful person in the land is actually their brother, who they sold into slavery 22 years before. He tests their brothers. They go back. You remember he keeps one of their brothers, Simeon, in prison. Poor Simeon. But he got kept in prison while the other brothers went home. They finally come back. This is one of the tests that Joseph has for them. And where we left off last week, they're enjoying a feast together. They passed the test. Simeon is out of prison. And all of the brothers are together having this meal. Joseph, in the midst of even that kind of feast, he's waiting for reconciliation to really happen with his family. Think of it, waiting 22 years to see the Lord heal what has been broken. Joseph walking up to the oven, opening it. Is the dinner ready yet? Is it ready yet? Is it ready yet, Lord? Waiting to see if there's actually a heart change in his brothers, if there's actually some kind of positive reconciliation that happens. And today we're going to see that beautiful reconciliation that happens in Joseph's family. Let's read together Genesis 44, beginning in verse 1. Then he commanded, Joseph commanded the steward of his house, fill the men's sacks with food. So this is right after dinner. The next morning, they're going to send them off with the food that they came to buy. Fill the men's sacks with food as much as they can carry, and put each man's money in the mouth of his sack, which is what he did before for each one of them. But there's something else, not just his money. And put my cup, the silver cup, in the mouth of the sack of the youngest. You remember who that is? Is Benjamin, the youngest brother Benjamin, with his money for the grain. And he did as Joseph told him. As soon as the morning was light, the men were sent away with their donkeys. They had gone only a short distance from the city. Here's Joseph's test. Now Joseph said to his steward, "Up, follow after the men. And when you overtake them, say to them, 'Why have you repaid evil for good? Is it not from this that my Lord drinks, and by this that he practices divination? You have done evil in doing this.'" So Joseph sets up this test again. Here he goes again with another test for his brothers. What in the world did Joseph's men think of this? And keep in mind, they don't know that they're Joseph's brothers yet. There's just these guys that keep coming back to the land, and Joseph keeps like messing with these guys. Okay, cup in the bag, all right. But here he is. I wonder if they're thinking, is he just being cruel? Maybe these guys did something to him and he wants revenge. It's pretty clear that Joseph does not want revenge on his brothers. If he wanted revenge, he would snap his fingers and they would all be annihilated. He had that kind of power. So what exactly is Joseph trying to do there? He wants to see if this reconciliation, if it will be genuine. Not just them acting like it because he's in a position of power and they're in a position of need. See, true reconciliation, true heart change, true healing needs to happen for there to be something positive. So he tests them. If you remember, this is the third test that Joseph has of his brothers. In chapter 42, he accused them of being spies. Keep Simeon in prison. They have to go get Benjamin and bring him back. He's testing them to see, are they going to sacrifice? Are they just going to leave one of their brothers for dead and save themselves? Will they give up on a brother? He's testing in chapter 42, are they selfish people? Are they selfish? And then in chapter 43, he gives this massive feast. And remember, he gives Benjamin tons more food than everyone else. Favor on a brother that isn't given to other brothers. Does that sound familiar to Joseph's story? What he's doing, he's testing, will they harbor jealousy against a favored son? Do these brothers, are they still jealous people? Are they selfish? Are they jealous? And then here in 44 with the cup and Benjamin's sack of grain, will they sacrifice themselves for love for one of their others? Will any of them take the place of an innocent brother? Will they see unity in their brotherhood? Will they sacrifice themselves, or will they just save themselves once again and sacrifice a favored son? So what's this going to be, brothers? What's it going to be? Let's look back at the text. Verse 6 then. When he overtook them, he spoke to them these words. They said, "Why does my Lord speak such words as these? Far be it from your servants to do such a thing. We would never do anything like that." Well, they're in for a shock. "Behold, the money that we found in the mouths of our sacks, we brought it back to you from the land of Canaan." You remember how that happened? We found all our money, but then we brought it back to show you that we're innocent of all this. "How then could we steal silver or gold from your Lord's house? We would never do that," they say. "Whichever of your servants is found with it shall die, and we also will be my Lord's servants." He said, "Let it be here as you say. He who is found with it shall be my servant, and the rest of you shall be innocent." Then each man quickly lowered his sack to the ground, and each man opened his sack, and he searched. And beginning with the eldest and ending with the youngest, here he is again, and the cup was found in Benjamin's sack. Can you feel it there for a moment as the brothers all drop their bags of grain. They're like, there's no way. We would never do that. Go ahead and look, look. And then they get to Benjamin's and their hearts sink. Then they tore their clothes, which is a sign of their hearts sinking right there. And every man loaded his donkey and they returned to the city. Joseph's testing. He's trying to determine, has the Lord really worked in them? And he puts them in a similar situation to what they were in when they sold Joseph into slavery. One brother among them is at risk. Now it's Benjamin instead of Joseph. This time it's Benjamin at risk. It's also out of the control of the brothers. So Joseph's test here, it's a recreation, really, of what they did to him. Will they sacrifice this favored son as they sacrificed Joseph? Will they do that in order to save themselves, in order to improve their own position? Or will they show brotherly love and unity where there once was hate and division between them? They can abandon Benjamin here. They can keep all their money. They can destroy their father and maybe improve their situation with the favored son gone. Or will they demonstrate their changed hearts? Which path is it going to be, brothers? Let's look at verse 14. When Judah and his brothers came to Joseph's house, he was still there. They fell before him to the ground. Notice, just like before in Joseph's dreams, now all of the brothers are before him, bowing before him. Joseph said to them, "What deed is this that you have done? Do you not know that a man like me can indeed practice divination?" And Judah said, "What shall we say to my Lord? What shall we speak, or how can we clear ourselves? We have been caught red-handed. I don't have anything to say to myself, save for myself. God has found out the guilt of your servants." It's interesting how Judah points to the Lord as finding out their guilt at this point. "Behold, we are my Lord's servants, both we and he also in whose hand the cup has been found." Judah has incredible unity in their brotherhood here. "We're all in this together. We're all your servants. Take us all." But he said, Joseph said, "Far be it from me that I should do so. Only the man in whose hand the cup was found shall be my servant. But as for you, go up in peace to your father." You're free to go. Don't worry about it. I mean, here, like before with Simeon, when he was there, kept in prison, they knew he was innocent. They weren't really doing anything. But here, I think as far as Judah knows, Benjamin did it. Like, I actually think he's like, "Oh, you caught us." I mean, and Benjamin, you can see him there like, "I didn't do anything." And they're like, "Dude, we found the cup. What do you mean you didn't do anything?" They're owning the guilt. Will they sacrifice themselves then for their brother? He does this testing. Joseph does this testing by using this silver cup that we hear about. Now, the cup would have had two purposes, really. First of all, it would have showed Joseph's station. It would have showed his position, that he had authority and wealth. The fact that he owned that cup would display that he was a person of importance and wealth. If you remember, Pharaoh had a cup. He had a cup bearer that then he sent to prison. And so this is Joseph's cup made of silver. It would have been very wealthy. And so it signified his position. It also, he says, it was used for divination. What they would actually do with the cups at times, they would put water and sometimes oil, and they would look at the way the ripples would fall. It's sort of like the reading the tea leaves kind of thing. And they would look at the things and believe that, "Oh, well, maybe we can tell the future based on the way that the oil goes," or things like that. And so that's what the Egyptians would do. It's interesting that Pharaoh had already noted when Joseph was interpreting his dreams. Pharaoh was like, "You can do it." And Joseph was very quick to say, "It's from the Lord. It's not in me at all." And here Joseph is setting them up and saying, I have powers of divination. Don't you know that? Don't you understand? And yet here it's Judah that points to God as the one who's truly found them out. But I have to say, if you're like me, when I read this passage again, I was like, wait. So Joseph has he's remained faithful to God. As far as we can tell, he hasn't sinned all along the way. The whole story, he's being faithful to the Lord. Why is he now using a cup for divination? What does this seem to mean? What's his point? Now, what I think he's actually doing is he's pointing back to their customs of this divination that they would use these cups. But he's using the cup hidden there to be able to tell if the brothers are true or false in that. That's the sort of divination I think that he's pointing to. I don't think he actually believes that the ripples in the cup mean anything. Remember, there's nothing in it but grain in the brothers' bag. But he's using this whole test to be able to tell where are their hearts before the Lord. Where are they? Where are their hearts in all of this? So let's do it. Let's use this silver cup to sort of divine where the brothers' hearts are at, where their truth or falsehood, not just in their words, but in their actual actions. And he quickly is like, God has found out the guilt of your servants. I wonder if Joseph is sitting there to himself thinking, maybe God's actually working in them. I see a little bit of them owning some guilt. Maybe the meal's ready. He's sort of checking the oven again. Maybe it's ready. Maybe the Lord's working here. Maybe dinner's actually done. For reconciliation to happen, true reconciliation, there needs to be a change in people's hearts. I think the rest of our time here, what we see from the rest of this passage, we see three elements to reconciliation from our text today. Three elements of true reconciliation. And first, true reconciliation, it takes heart change. True reconciliation takes heart change. Let's see if the brothers' hearts really are changed. Now, chapter 44, verse 18. Then Judah went up to him and said, "Oh, my lord, please let your servant speak a word in my lord's ears, and let not your anger burn against your servant, for you are like Pharaoh himself. My lord, ask his servants, saying, 'Have you a father or a brother?' And we said to my lord, 'We have a father, an old man, and a young brother, the child of his old age. His brother is dead, and he alone is left of his mother's children, and his father loves him.' Then you said to your servants, 'Bring him down to me that I may set my eyes on him.' And we said to my lord, 'The boy cannot leave his father. For if he should leave his father would die.' Then you said to your servants," see, he's recounting all the, remember what happened. "Then you said to your servants, 'Unless your youngest brother comes down with you, you shall not see my face again.' When we went back to your servant, my father, we told him the words of my lord. And when our father said, 'Go again, buy us a little food,' we said, 'We cannot go down. For if our youngest brother goes with us, then we will go down. For we cannot see the man's face unless our youngest brother is with us.' Then your servant, my father, said to us, 'You know that my wife bore me two sons. One left me, and I said, surely he has been torn to pieces, and I have never seen him since.'" It's interesting, as far as we can tell, this is the first time that Joseph knows what his father Jacob thinks happened to him. Oh, he thinks I was torn to shreds. Before this point, 22 years gone by, not knowing what does my father even think happened to me. Now he knows. And I have never seen him since. If you take this one, Benjamin, also from me, and if harm happens to him, you will bring down my gray hairs in evil to Sheol." So they're recounting these things to him. Now remember, we have a narrator. Like, we know the whole story. It's super easy for us in our time to be like, it's going to be fine. I mean, it's really like just a couple pages since the last thing. But think about it from Joseph's perspective. 22 years have gone by. How many times did he check the oven in those 22 years? God, are you working? God, are you doing anything here? The up and the down from the pit to favor and back to the pit and back to favor and back to the pit over and over in Joseph's life, feeling all of these things. And here we're finally, he's finally piecing together some of the story that happens. Let's continue reading this passage, verse 30. Now therefore, this is his speech still, as soon as I come to your servant with my father and the boy is not with us. Listen, if we go back to our dad and I don't have Benjamin with us, what's going to happen? And the boy is not with us, then as his life is bound up in the boy's life, as soon as he sees that the boy is not with us, he will die. And your servants will bring down the gray hairs of your servant, our father, with sorrow to Sheol. For your servant became a pledge of safety. Joseph's learning more of the story that Judah put himself on the line. Now remember, we know that because we read that part. Joseph doesn't know that until right now, that Judah put himself as a pledge of safety for the boy to my father, saying, if I do not bring him back to you, then I shall bear the blame before my father all my life. Now, therefore, please let your servant remain instead of the boy as a servant to my Lord. And let the boy go back with his brothers. For how can I go back to my father if the boy is not with me? For I fear to see the evil that would find my father. Judah has been, he's had this plan with Jacob, and we've known about it, but he's just now sharing it with Joseph. He comes forward and tells him of this plan. I'm a pledge of safety for him. It shows the unity in their brotherhood. Think of it. Judah was the one who was like, let's not kill him, let's get money for him. That's the last thing that Joseph really knew of his brother Judah. And here he hears that he's a pledge of safety. There's an amazing speech that Judah makes for this. And a speech that's backed up by action. It's not just words. There's a couple of things about what Judah says that are really pretty incredible. First of all, it has like no spin at all. There's no like trying to make himself look good. It's a truthful recounting of events. It doesn't twist the truth. It doesn't make himself sound great. Listen, when a person's description of what actually happened truly matches reality, now you're on the right path. And not a making excuses, not a, well, I did that because, or maybe it's, but actually matching reality. Judah does that. His little speech here is also very, very other focused. He actually uses the word father 15 times just in this little speech. My father, he's so concerned with how his father's going to react in all of this. He's concerned for Benjamin's life, for Benjamin himself, but also for the ways in which that is going to affect his father. And he's willingly giving himself up so that Benjamin can live and his father can see his favored son still. Something significant has really happened in Judah's heart. There is heart change that's happened. He's a changed man, and he's willing to sacrifice himself for the sake of others instead of sacrificing one of his brothers to save himself. Now, like, imagine Joseph at this moment. You've set up this test, your third test. Judah is apparently like remarkably changed. You almost gave in to emotions before. Remember, he kept having to go away and hide himself to weep and then wash his face and come back. He's felt all of these things before, and now he hears all of this again, thinking about how his father, who loved him, now believes he was dead, believes he was torn to pieces. He can't hold it back anymore. And that's where Joseph is at. But I think we learned something really important from Judah at this point, that coming clean is always the right thing to do. Owning the guilt, the Lord has shown his guilt to us. He's found us out. Maybe you find yourself in the place of Judah and his brothers. Hopefully none of you have sold your sibling into slavery. But maybe as you look over the landscape of your life and you look back over the weeks and months and maybe years in the past, you can think of some things that I did not act with love in that situation. I put myself above others and it really hurt some people. Maybe you find yourself in that, in those quiet, those still moments of life when there's not so much noise around you or things going on. You're still haunted by some of the things that you did, that we did in the past, that you haven't apologized for. You haven't owned those things to the people who you've hurt. You've sort of brushed them under the rug. It's in the past. We're not going to worry about that anymore. All I can deal with is the future. But you haven't actually owned the guilt that you're to bear. See, we often hold on to the ways that we've been hurt by others. And I own these things and I label these things and I let them affect me all of the times. I hold on to the ways that I've been hurt, but we fail oftentimes to own up to the things that I have done that contribute to the problem, the things that I have done to hurt others. So own your part. Maybe something this week for each one of us is to take some time and think through the ways that we have hurt others. Who's that person that you need to go to and apologize for? I did this. I have no excuse. I was wrong. Please forgive me. There's incredible grace and power that happens when we own up to the ways that we have fallen short, the ways that we have hurt others. And true, beautiful reconciliation can happen when we do those things. Joseph's test, it's showing that his brothers have changed, that they've actually changed, that it's not just words, but they've actually changed. Don't tell me that you have changed. Show me how you've changed. Show that life, that heart change has happened in you. Joseph has heard of the remorse of his brothers, even in chapter 42. But he wants to see it for real. And he sets up these tests so that he can see it. Because true repentance is something that's seen, not just something that's said. They recognize that they've wronged him. If you're waiting for reconciliation to happen in your life, in your family, maybe this week over Thanksgiving, if you're waiting for true reconciliation to happen, start with a changed heart before God, because that's when power and beauty rushes in. Secondly, true reconciliation requires total forgiveness. True reconciliation requires total forgiveness. Let's continue reading chapter 45 now. Then Joseph could not control himself before those who stood by him, his emotions welling up again. He cried, "Make everyone go out for me." So no one stayed with him when Joseph made himself known to his brothers. And he wept aloud so that the Egyptians heard it. Can you picture them in the other room like, what in the world is happening in there? But they heard it. And the house of Pharaoh heard it. And Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph." I mean, can you feel that right there? As their hearts sunk. Wait, who? "I'm Joseph. Is my father still alive?" But his brothers could not answer him. That's basically what they were doing. for they were dismayed at his presence. That's what dismayed means, is like that. So Joseph said to his brothers, come near to me, please. And they came near, and he said, I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into slavery. It's beautiful forgiveness that's offered here. In verse 1 and 3, where he says he was not able to control himself anymore. Do you remember back in chapter 37, 4, where his brothers saw that his father loved Joseph more than all of his brothers, and that it says that they hated him and could not speak. They were not able to speak. It's the same word. And here he can't control his love for them. At the beginning of the story, the brothers, they could not contain their hate. And here Joseph could not contain his love for them. And his brothers could not contain their shock in all of it. Where they could only speak cruelty towards Joseph before, now they can't speak at all as their jaws are on the floor. But Joseph, he can't control himself. He has to reveal himself and immediately shows them grace and kindness, because there's total forgiveness on Joseph's part. Joseph had worked for a long time before this moment happened. We just see it in an instant that he just offers forgiveness to his brother. But the Lord had been doing a work in his heart over those decades so that he could show forgiveness to them. It's a choice to release the person who has hurt you, to let them go, to say, you don't owe me anything for what you did wrong to me. You don't have to make it up to me. You don't owe me. That's what it means. Last week, we did talk about the necessary step that we each need to take when we're hurt of grieving the wrong that was done to you. And we do need to do that as a part of forgiveness. It's grieving the hurt and the pain, sometimes with anger before the Lord, but allowing the Lord to transform our hearts through that. But forgiveness, it doesn't mean that it won't still hurt. It doesn't mean that I'm putting myself in a position to have those exact same things happen again. It means you don't owe me anything for what you did to me. You don't have to make it up to me. I'm letting it go. I'm releasing it. You don't have to pay me back. And it's a beautiful thing to do that to another person. What Joseph is doing to his brothers is, after all that they have done to him and all of the hardship that he's been through, he's giving them a fresh start. You don't owe me any of that. It's a beautiful thing to give another person a fresh start when they've hurt you in the past. Because what we do is we sort of timestamp people. You know what I'm talking about? Like, you have this image in your mind of what a person was like 10 years ago, back when they hurt me, what she did to me last week. I'm holding on to that picture of that person. It's like a photograph of a person you haven't seen in a long time. I was at a conference this week with some of our pastors and saw a friend of mine from years ago, and it was like, whoa, like, because I had this picture in my head of what he looked like a long time ago. He looks a whole lot older now, but don't tell him I said that. But I had this picture of what he looked like. That was sort of my timestamp of him. But that didn't match reality today. And we do that with people. We do that with people who've hurt us. And we say, he was like this. He was this person. But we don't allow the Lord to work on a person's heart over the years and to change them little by little by little, and then give them a fresh start today with who they might be. We need to stop time stamping people and give them a fresh start. Paul, a persecutor of the church, if you were to picture Paul as he's dragging Christians off to prison, and you have a picture of who Paul is But he met Jesus and was miraculously changed and became an incredible apostle and evangelist. And think about all of the books of scripture that we have. How wrong of us to look back and be like, yeah, but you persecuted the church. We're not time stamping a person. The Lord has done a work, and so we're forgiving that person. It's like, have you ever gone back to a place that, like, maybe a place that you grew up and you drive back to that place and you're driving through and you're like, wow, that place is an IKEA. I remember it when it was a cornfield, and all the kids are in the back seat like, we know that, you know? But we do that. We go to that place, and it is so very different. It doesn't even look like the same place that I was at before. We need to allow the Lord to create a fresh start for people. That my relationship with them, I'm going to release them from the pain and the hurt that they caused me. And I'm going to allow them to have a fresh start and see how the Lord has changed them, what he might have done in their life. There's something beautiful and powerful that happens when these two things happen together. When true heart change happens, done from the Lord in a person's heart, and when I'm able to release a person and forgive them and give them a fresh start, a beautiful and powerful reconciliation can happen. And I know, like, listening to me today, there are tons of people who are working through a process of forgiveness for someone. And I know it. It's not a moment in time. It's a work to continually bring yourself back to the Lord and say, I'm releasing this person from what they did. And I know that there are many, many people waiting for heart change to happen in another person. That you're working on that forgiveness in your own heart, and you're praying and hoping and longing for the day when you can stand before them and proclaim your forgiveness and say, like Joseph did, come near, brothers, come near. Still waiting, looking in the oven, waiting for the meal to be done, still hoping for that heart change, but knowing that it's possible. Think of the incredible pain that was caused to Joseph. I've had a lot of things done to me. I've never been sold into slavery by my siblings. I've had a lot of things done to me. I've never been falsely accused and thrown into prison for years. I've had a lot of things done to me. I've never been forgotten in the pit for 2 years. And yet Joseph is able to forgive and to give his brothers a fresh start. In the meantime, as we wait for that heart change to happen in people's lives, we do the hard work of forgiveness in our own hearts. Colossians 3 is a passage that we're somewhat familiar with. Colossians 3, 12 and 13, we're encouraged by Paul, one who persecuted the church, put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved. Think about these things and how you see them in Joseph's life. Compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another. If one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other. How am I to forgive? As the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. This is the type of forgiveness that we're called for. We've all been wronged. In your relationships, are you holding on to some of the pain, to some of the hurt, to some of the things that people have done to you instead of releasing them, forgiving them as the Lord has forgiven us, choosing to release people from the hurt that they have done to you? Beautiful reconciliation can happen when we do this. And third and finally, true reconciliation, it celebrates God's providence. True reconciliation celebrates God's providence. Let's continue to read in Genesis 45. And now do not be distressed. This is Joseph again speaking to his brothers. Do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land these 2 years, and there are yet 5 years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. The brothers don't know this at this point, but he's telling him, guys, we got several more years of this, and I'm going to take care of you the whole time. And God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. He's made me a father to Pharaoh and lord of all his house and a ruler over all the land of Egypt. Hurry, hurry, and go up to my father and say to him, thus says your son Joseph, God has made me lord of all Egypt. Come down to me and do not tarry. You shall dwell in the land of Goshen, and you shall be near me, and you and your children and your children's children and your flocks and your herds and all that you have. Bring everything. Put it on a trailer and drive it over. There I will provide for you, for there are yet 5 years of famine to come, so that you and your household and all that you have do not come to poverty. And now your eyes see, and the eyes of my brother Benjamin see, that is in my mouth that speaks to you. There is incredible grace that Joseph shows to his brothers here. Think of the ways that he's taken care of. It's not even just, hey, I forgive you guys, no harm, no foul. See you later. It's none of that. He's come, take the best part of the land. I've been holding it. And I'm going to give it to you. I'm going to take care of everybody. There's this famine that's coming. It's going to be so bad. But I got it. I'm taking care of everybody. Look at all the stuff that I have. It's all yours. I'm taking care of you. Incredible grace. When God does a change in your heart to forgive somebody like that, grace flows beautifully. It's my mouth that speaks to you. You must tell my father of all my honor in Egypt and all that you have seen. Hurry and bring my father down here. Then he fell upon his brother Benjamin's neck and wept. And Benjamin wept upon his neck, and he kissed all his brothers and wept upon them. After that, his brothers talked with him. I mean, it's a beautiful thing that happens here. Even when I can't see it, God's working. Think of all of the years that Joseph couldn't see any change in his family. They were far away. And then he gets these glimpses of them and what's happened in them and all of that. But he didn't know the ways that God had been working all along. A huge motivation for Joseph that we see in this text for his forgiveness and for the reconciliation that he has is God's providence. It's part of God's plan. He may not have been able to see it when he was in chains walking to Egypt, having been sold by his brothers, but God was working. He may not have been able to see it when he was a slave in Potiphar's house, but God was working. He may not have been able to see it when he was in prison after being falsely accused, but God was working. He may not have been able to see it when he was forgotten for 2 whole years, but God was working, and now he can see it. And I have to say, brothers and sisters, you may not see it right now, but God is working in your life. God is working for your good and for his purposes. And there's a lot of days that you're in the pit. And there's a lot of days that you're just going through the motions and serving all of the time, these 2 years that Joseph's even serving in Pharaoh's house and doing his best and being faithful and not seeing God work in his family. But God was working in their hearts all along. And now he sees it. Now he can walk up to the oven and there's a different story. He sees how God was the one accomplishing his purposes. Look back at a couple of these. He says, don't be distressed. What? God sent me here. And there will be 5 years in which, and God sent me to preserve. It was not you who sent me, but God. He's made me Lord over Pharaoh, all of these. God has made me over and over. God has made me. He sees this time and time again, that God is the one who did it. That in all of the seasons where he wasn't seeing anything at work, now God is doing all of this. He sees it now. The turkey is done. I can open the oven and see all of the beautiful ways that God was writing this story, the years, the decades that Joseph saw nothing happening. And yet God was at work, because true reconciliation celebrates God's providence along the way. It looks past the hurt, it looks past the pain, it looks past all of the things that have happened in my life that I so desperately wish had been different. And it sees them with a mindset of faith, maybe just in part even at times, this thread that God was weaving all along the way. And I don't really know how. I don't totally understand it, I'll be honest. But I believe that somehow a life where brokenness happens and is redeemed and healed, that it's better than one where brokenness never occurred. We, brothers and sisters, we're people of the cross. We see the evil becoming good. Even the seasons when you don't see it. Think of the 3 days where the disciples were looking at that bloodied cross and staring at a closed tomb and thinking, God, what in the world are you doing? But God was working through all of it. We are people who celebrate God's providence in the most evil of all things, the brutal killing of the sinless Son of God. And it produced the greatest victory for us. So when we look at the mess of our lives at times, no family is too far gone that reconciliation can't happen. No hurt is too much that forgiveness can't be granted. No person is too far gone that the blood of Jesus can't redeem them. Maybe the dinner, it's not done yet. Maybe you're still checking on the oven. But in the meantime, brothers and sisters, we can forgive the wrongdoing that's been done to us. And we can celebrate God's providence at work in our lives, even when we haven't seen the end yet. We can see the Lord's goodness in all things. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for this message of Joseph and for the ways that you have shown us time and time again of your hand upon him and the hand upon his story and the countless ways that you have worked. God, we have seen from pit to favor and back to pit and some of the hardships that he's experienced. And Lord, we can only even really understand that in part just as we read these pages, but we can look at all of it and see your hand of goodness upon him. And God, give us faith to see now what Joseph saw at the end. For those of us who are in the middle of it and still waiting, God, we would pray that you would give us those eyes of faith to see your hand of providence upon the situations. That there will come a day that we will be able to look back and say, God sent me. God did it. God made me. God sent me through all of this. And know that your hand is upon us. In the meantime, Lord, give us forgiveness that we can grant as you have given us forgiveness in the person of Jesus Christ. Allow us to model your love and your sacrifice and your forgiveness for us in that way to those who are in our lives. And we would pray, Lord, that you would work in miraculous ways, showing yourself strong, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand and sing.
The God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations.
will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean. I need you now to do the same thing for me. Hold on, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, now I'm standing.
Amen. Amen, church. He is the same God. The same God that was working in the life of Joseph is the same God that is working in our lives today. And he's calling us to respond. To respond what he is saying to you today. He's calling us to go and reconcile well people. He's asking us to live in his power, to go and be the light in the middle of darkness. Right? And we need to be reminded of that. If you would like somebody to pray with you today, we have some people up in the front that would love to pray with you. Please come to do that. If you're new, I would love to meet you out there in the lobby so that I can get to know you a little bit better. But something that we remind ourselves every single week, because many times we need to be reminded of this, right? Like we say in Harvest in Español, ustedes son amados. Don't forget that you are loved.